Harper Business and Harper Audio present Say It Well. Find your voice, speak your mind, inspire any audience. By Terry Szuplat, White House speechwriter for Barack Obama. Read by Sean Patrick Hopkins. A note before we begin. Don't forget to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. It contains writing suggestions and tips and will be referred to throughout as the enhancement. For Mary, Jack, and Claire. Let me think clearly and brightly. Let me live, love, and say it well in good sentences. Let me someday see who I am. Sylvia Plath. Introduction. The way we talk. I was shaking. It was almost time for me to speak, and I could feel my heart starting to race. I shifted anxiously in my seat, desperately thinking of ways to escape. I don't have to do this. I'll just smile and politely decline. No thanks, not tonight, maybe another time. Disaster averted, dignity preserved. But it was too late. And now, a voice announced, give it up for Terry. Every eye in the room was on me. I started to talk into the microphone, but I sensed my voice trembling. Then I thought about the audience hearing my voice trembling, which only made my voice tremble more. I tried to hold the pages of my speech steady, but my hands were shaking. I thought about the audience seeing my hands shaking, which only made them shake more. For a moment, I felt like I was out of my body, floating above, looking down on myself as I stammered and quivered. My mouth was moving, but the only sound I heard was the voice of doubt in my head. They can see that you're nervous. You're going to screw up and embarrass yourself. Please, just let this be over. The way I was stressing out, you'd think I was delivering a major address to a huge audience. Far from it. I was in a karaoke bar with my coworkers, fellow staffers at the White House, where I was a speechwriter for President Barack Obama. We were on a work trip in Yokohama, Japan, and after a week of grueling international travel, we'd gone out for the night to unwind. I knew the audience. They were my friends. I spoke from my seat and didn't even have to stand up. In fact, I wasn't even delivering a speech or doing karaoke at all. It was a silly little skit I'd written about Obama and other world leaders scrambling to pull the world economy out of a ditch like a wrecked car. A fun parody of a story Obama loved to tell back home on the campaign trail. In other words, it was no big deal. It didn't matter whether I nailed it or flopped, which made my nerves all the more frustrating. Why was this happening? In my gut, I knew. Even though I've been a professional speechwriter for nearly my entire adult life, for most of that time, I'd been uncomfortable with public speaking myself. I was a speech writer who couldn't seem to hack it as a speech giver. It's not like I avoided public speaking altogether. I could usually handle talking to a small group or giving a eulogy at a family funeral, and sometimes I wasn't half bad. Most of the time, though, just the idea of speaking in front of a group of people left me racked with anxiety. So, for most of my life, I largely stayed where I felt safe, behind the scenes, writing speeches for others. But I paid a price. I spent so many years helping President Obama and other leaders speak in their voice that, over time, I lost my own. I coached speakers on how to tell their stories. But the idea of sharing mine could be nauseating. I was able to draft remarks for Obama, who even his critics agree is one of the world's great speakers, but I struggled with a meaningless skit. Somehow, I made it through that night at the bar, though it's mostly a blur. My coworkers laughed and applauded, but walking back to our hotel through the empty streets of a city far from home, I felt helpless. All I could do, it seemed, was hope that my fear of public speaking might fade over time. It didn't. When Obama's presidency was over, I left the White House and tried putting myself out there more, doing interviews and speaking to small classes of college students. Sometimes I was fine, other times, not so much. During one live TV interview, I tensed up, started stumbling over my words, and then just stopped talking altogether. I froze. Mercifully, the interviewer ended the segment, and I darted out of the studio, embarrassed. Another time, on a conference call with a group of young foreign policy activists, my mouth dried up in the middle of my presentation, sending me into a full-on coughing spasm. The host put me on mute while I lunged for a glass of water and tried to collect myself. At an intimate dinner with colleagues, everyone around the table took turns giving toasts and then looked at me to offer one as well. But I couldn't summon the courage. I just sat there looking down at my plate. After a few seconds of awkward silence, the conversation moved on, and I spent the rest of the evening replaying my party foul in my mind. Clearly, I wasn't meant to be a public speaker, or a private speaker. As time went on, I tried to avoid it as much as possible. If someone invited me to talk to their group about working at the White House, I made up an excuse about why I couldn't. At dinners, I watched silently as others delivered toasts that got everyone raising their glasses. For me, it just felt safer not to speak. Then, one day, an unexpected phone call forced me to face my fears. "Hello, this is Antti Mustakallio," said the voice on the other end of the line, in a crisp Nordic accent. He said he was one of the very few speechwriters in Finland. "So, I hear you give a lot of speeches about giving speeches," he asked. "Oh, absolutely," I said, mustering as much false confidence as I could. "I love it." Antti wanted me to come to a conference later that year in his hometown of Hämeenlinna, a few hundred miles from the Arctic Circle, in November. "I would like you to deliver a keynote speech about how to deliver a speech. It will be on stage with an audience of 300 people. I almost hung up. Antti kept talking, but I wasn't really listening. The scenes of my past failures flashed through my mind. "I'll think about it," I told him, with no intention of thinking about it. But then, in the days that followed, I began to think about it. I was now in my late 40s. I was being given a great opportunity, which I'd miss if I let my fears continue to control me. How many more experiences would I pass up and later come to regret? Was I going to hide from public speaking for the rest of my life? Plus, what was the worst that could happen? If I flopped, no one back home would know. It would be in Finland, in November. Maybe I could do this. Maybe this time could be different. Maybe I could try to remember the lessons I'd learned as a speechwriter, including for President Obama, and use them to develop and deliver a speech for myself. Fortunately, I had plenty of lessons to draw on. I was fortunate to write for Barack Obama across all 8 years of his presidency. It was the most exhilarating and uplifting, and at times exhausting and terrifying, experience of my professional life. I learned from him every day as he connected with audiences around the world, which I witnessed up close while joining him on trips to more than 40 countries. In Kenya, flying with Obama aboard the presidential helicopter Marine One, I looked down and saw the streets of Nairobi filled with people ecstatic over his return to his father's country, some with handmade signs that read, "Welcome home." In Vietnam, where throngs of people lined the streets of Ho Chi Minh City to get a glimpse of his motorcade, the crowd, perhaps thinking they'd seen Obama, broke through the police line and chased me and other staff into a hotel. The crush of the crowd was so strong in Tanzania that our staff bus got separated from the motorcade and hit a telephone pole, which smashed one of the bus's windows and sent shattered glass across the laps of frightened staff. Moments like that could be nerve-wracking, but they were also revealing. With the power of his words and story of his life, Obama tapped into something universal. Ideals, values, and aspirations that transcend boundaries of race, religion, country, and culture, and how he connected with his audiences, including people who didn't necessarily agree with his politics, can offer lessons for us all. When I started writing this book, a speechwriter I'd worked with at the White House joked, "What? You're going to give away all our secrets?" Well, yeah, and why not? Yes, speechwriters are supposed to be ghosts, heard but not seen. And for more than 25 years, that was me, behind the scenes, largely invisible, penning the words in private that a president, members of Congress, executives, activists, and celebrities spoke in public. But why should these leaders be the only ones to benefit from these skills? The art of public speaking is a skill we all need, now more than ever. It's been 2 decades since a presidential speechwriter offered a book of advice on public speaking. Since then, the world has changed. A new generation of young people, diverse, restless, hopeful, are raising their voices, demanding to be heard. We're finally beginning to talk more openly about systemic issues that for too long were swept under the rug. Everyone, whether you're an elected official, a business executive, or a school principal, is now expected to speak to world events and complex issues of race, religion, and individual rights. At the same time, raging political and social debates have turned language into a battlefield where words are wielded like weapons. Some people seem oblivious to how language from a bygone era, especially around race, can inflict pain on communities that historically have been marginalized. Other people can sometimes be quick to shame or condemn well-intentioned family, friends, or colleagues who struggle to keep pace with the rapidly evolving vocabulary around identity, sex, and gender. From what I can tell, most people feel caught between the front lines, trapped in a rhetorical no man's land, not wanting to fall back on the coarse language of a cruel past, but unsure how to move forward without misstepping and setting off a linguistic landmine that can destroy their relationships, career, or reputation. We've lost, it seems, the ability to communicate with one another. Too many leaders seem more intent on scoring rhetorical points against their opponents than engaging in the dialogue that democracy needs in order to function. Too many speakers seem more eager to drown out those with different views than to practice the persuasion that brings more people to their cause. Our airways and communities are flooded with misinformation and cruelty, vitriol that undermines the trust, understanding, and shared sense of purpose that we need to live and work together. The way we talk has to change. I worry, though, that just when we need it the most, the art of public speaking often seems more complicated and intimidating than it needs to be. Too many books on rhetoric have overlooked the voices of women, people of color, and historically marginalized communities. Some books on public speaking can make your head spin with obscure words from ancient Greece and Rome. But I'm here to tell you that you don't need to know what chiasmus is to be a great speaker. One thing Obama never told us was, "You know, this is a good speech, but what it really needs is more chiasmus." Chiasmus is a rhetorical device in which a phrase mirrors a previous phrase in reverse, like when President John F. Kennedy said, "Ask not what your country can do for you, ask what you can do for your country." And yes, sometimes Obama used it, like when he said, "My job is not to represent Washington to you, but to represent you to Washington." More often, though, Obama's rhetoric was rooted in direct and straightforward language, which reflected his belief not in the power of leaders to inspire their people, but in the power of the people to inspire their leaders. See what I did there? All the while, technology continues to transform how we talk to one another. For the first time in history, every one of us has a megaphone, our smartphones, social media, and Zoom, that allows us to instantly share our voice with the world, with all the power and peril that it brings. With the rise of artificial intelligence, chatbots are revolutionizing how we learn, create, and communicate, with untold benefits and dangers. This may be the first book on public speaking in the age of AI, and I'll offer some thoughts on how we might harness this technology to sharpen our voice without losing the humanity that's at the heart of all great communication. In short, the art of public speaking needs an upgrade, a new guide for our diverse and changing world, with practical tools for the presentations, pitches, talks, toasts, and tributes that we give in our daily lives. I hope this book can be that guide for you. But before we dive in, I have a confession. I never read a book about public speaking or took a class on rhetoric before I became a speechwriter. Every lesson I'll share in the chapters that follow, I learned by doing. This is the book I wish I'd had when I started out on my own journey. I'll take you behind the scenes at the White House, into the Oval Office and aboard Air Force One, and share never-before-heard insights from President Obama.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.